Let's settle this once and for all. What is the best way to pack a carry-on according to science? No more myths. Do packing cubes actually save space? What's the proper way to arrange your luggage? And how can you pack to minimize stress at the airport? Whether you use a backpack or a suitcase, these science-backed carry-on packing tips will save you both money and headaches. So grab your goggles, let's do science. When packing your suitcase, is it better to fold or roll your clothes? When you roll your clothes, you're compressing them into tight cylindrical shapes. This compression minimizes the amount of empty space or air pockets in between items. Theoretically, this means that you can fit more stuff into your bag, but I decided to put it to the test. In this super scientific experiment, I jammed as many clothes as possible into this small-sized packing cube using the folding method, the rolling method, and the cramming method. The results show that indeed, rolling saves more space compared to folding. And I'm sure the difference would be even bigger if you used a bigger sized packing cube. The cramming method is also proven to save space if you're a psycho. To take things to the extreme, you could even use Ziploc bags or vacuum bags to suck all the air out of your clothes. The downside is, if everything in your bag is perfectly vacuum sealed, then it's gonna be a pain to repack your bag. This may not be a big deal if you're just moving one time, but if you're hopping around the place, it's going to get old fast. Cramming things this efficiently also puts you at higher risk of your suitcase being overweight. We got caught red-handed with overweight carry-ons on a recent flight, and you can see how we minimized the fees we had to pay in this video on avoiding carry-on packing mistakes. So wait, why did I say that folding is sometimes better than rolling? Well, in another one of my professional lab tests, it took 77 seconds to roll 6 shirts as fast as I could, but it only took 36 seconds to fold them. That's over twice as fast. So if you value packing speed over maximizing every inch of space, then folding is the way to go. What do you think is the best way to pack clothes? Comment fold or roll and let's see who wins. Okay, so do packing cubes actually save space in your bag? Many people swear by them, but let's look at this scientifically. Packing cubes are made up of matter. And by definition, matter takes up space. Therefore, packing cubes do not save space. They actually take up more space. That said, packing cubes do help with organization. Technically, yes, you could fit slightly more in your bag by rolling up your clothes tightly and jamming them directly into your carry-on instead of using packing cubes. But is that really the way you want to live your life? With clothes scattered around loosey-goosey, always having to re-roll things every time you dig into your bag? If it's a short weekend trip or you're traveling personal item only on a budget airline, then the chaos may be worth the few extra cubic centimeters that you get. But in most other cases, packing cubes are a game changer for your sanity. Keep in mind that when it comes to packing cubes, bigger isn't necessarily always better. You actually want to choose the smallest size packing cube that fits all the clothes that you want to fit. I use a blue medium-sized packing cube for my tops, a black medium-sized for my bottoms, a black small size for my socks and underwear, and a black extra small for my random electronics. I'll link to these exact cubes below, which have held up strong for the past 8 years, and I'll also link to some bigger ones that my wife uses in case you want to pack more. But what about if you need to pack clothes that wrinkle by just looking at them? In this case, I don't recommend rolling or folding. Here, you're gonna want a bundle. Science says that wrinkles form when heat and or water cause the molecular bonds to break inside the fabric and then reform in the wrinkle position. In our luggage, we don't have much control over the heat or the water, but we do have control over two important things. One, choosing fabrics whose molecular bonds are harder to break, like nylon and polyester. And two, packing in a way that minimizes the wrinkly positions. To do this, first you want to lay out all your clothes in a stack with the most wrinkle-prone garments on the bottom of the stack and the most non-wrinkly fabrics on the top, like socks or underwear or sports clothes. These non-wrinkly clothes will form the core of your bundle. From there, start bundling it all up, making sure to create tension and smoothing out the wrinkles on each layer before you move on to the next layer. Then, when you make it to your most wrinkle-prone clothes, the size of the bundle makes it so there's no sharp creases. Seems like a genius idea at first, but can you see the downside to this method? Getting to the clothes at the inside of the bundle is no easy task without making a big mess. If you're traveling regularly for business, you're probably better off just picking up one of these travel garment folders. And if you have fancy clothes made of fragile material, you can use tissue paper to protect it from friction and wrinkles and other damage. Next, when you pack your luggage, you want to leverage the center of gravity. Put simply, this is the imaginary balance point where your entire bag's weight is concentrated. When packing a rolling suitcase, you want to use the lowest center of gravity possible. This makes it more stable and less likely to tip over. And if you're packing a backpack, you want the center of gravity to be closest to the part that touches your back. The farther that it is away from your back, the heavier your bag will feel. And if the center of gravity is really far back, you may actually have to lean forward with bad posture to prevent yourself from tipping backwards. Trust me on this one. This is a recipe for an achy body. This is harder than Patagonia. Your carry-on's center of gravity is determined by where you pack your heaviest stuff. So for rolling suitcases, pack your heaviest stuff at the bottom, and for backpacks, pack your heaviest stuff closest to your back. So now I want you to imagine taking a wine tasting tour on your trip and picking up a fine bottle of wine to bring home with you. You need to pack it in a checked bag because it's over the liquids limit. But when you get home and pick your bag off the luggage carousel, you notice that it feels a little damp. Uh-oh. Turns out the luggage handlers were feeling a little aggressive that day, and now your fancy wine has ruined all of your clothes. Luckily, this did not happen to us on our wine tasting trip in Chile because we used the shock absorber strategy. The goal here is to create a giant protective cocoon around your fragile item and pack it in the center of your check bag, ideally surrounded by soft clothes. It also helps to fill dead space in your bag to minimize movements. So if you have empty space, find soft things to fill it with to prevent your fragile items from shifting around and slamming around on the inside of your bag when the luggage handlers toss it around. Minimizing dead space does more than just prevent your stuff from shifting around. You can also take this idea to the extreme to fit more things in your luggage. For example, packed shoes can be filled with sandwich bags filled of socks and stuffed inside the shoes. Depending on the shape of your bag and the specific items that you're packing, you may have to dust off your Tetris skills so that you can cram things into every nook and cranny. The specific items that you choose to pack can make a huge difference with this. One giant packing mistake that I made on this year-long trip that we're currently on is these blasted exercise rings. I've barely used them, and it turns out that circles create tons of dead space that's hard to fill in your bags. This next one is less about packing and more about protecting your luggage, and it's something that most people don't think about. I've hauled my backpacks all around the world now for over 8 years and counting, from Patagonia to Portugal to the Maldives. And let me tell you, I am not gentle with these bags. I drag them on the ground, I sit on them when I need someplace to sit, and I cram them so full that I'm still surprised that the seams haven't exploded. But you wanna know what has ruined every single one of my backpacks? salt. Salt and moisture in the air can corrode your metal zippers, even if they never actually touch salt water. And let me tell you, it's a shame to have to throw away a perfectly good backpack just because the rusted zipper makes it unusable. The same goes for packing cubes or anything else with metal zippers. So if you travel near a beach, always rinse your zippers with fresh water and vinegar when you get home, and then let it dry out completely. Before we get into the stress stabilizer strategy, make sure to subscribe for more travel tips videos like this one. The way you pack for travel has a direct impact on your stress levels. Stress is a biological response to being in a state of worry or mental tension that causes spikes in cortisol and adrenaline. Now, I want you to close your eyes for a second and imagine you're rushing through the airport thinking to yourself, "Did I forget to pack something? Will I make it to my gate on time? Will the airlines weigh my heavy bags and charge me extra? Will airport security tear through my luggage and make me late? What if I misplace my passport during all this rush?" This, my friends, is what I call a stress sandwich. The good news is there's an easy solution, and that is a fanny pack. A good fanny pack stops many stressors in their tracks. Now hear me out. You have all your important documents attached to you, so you don't have to worry about losing anything. You also can put your valuables in it and zip it up when passing through security, so you don't have to worry about anything getting stolen from the bins. Also, you can pack extra stuff in it, so you don't have to worry about space and weight quite as much. Just make sure your fanny pack is low key. I'll link to this awesome one that I use below that has never caused me any problems. I surveyed a small group of fanny pack users and found that it reduces airport stress by an average of 41%. This is especially true when passing through airport security, because when things go wrong there, stress levels skyrocket. But using a fanny pack is only one thing that you can do to avoid problems when passing through airport security. For a complete list of TSA line mistakes to avoid, check out this video next. And don't forget to share your favorite packing tip in the comments to help everyone else who's watching this. All right, guys, bye-bye.